Hi, Anita.
Hi.
You can hear me properly, isn't it? Can you speak? Anita?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Now you are audible. You are in OT.
I'm at work.
Okay, yeah.
Good afternoon to all. Welcome all of you to Trivandrum Institute of Palliative Science, and today we have our last session. And today we have two sessions. The first part that is care at the end of life. The session will be carried by Dr. Minida. Welcome, ma'am. And the second part will be carried by Smriti, ma'am. That is bereavement in grief and bereavement in the context of COVID-19. And over to Sunil sir to facilitate this session.
Thank you, Arun. Good afternoon. We are to our last session in the COVID series. And we know that there are many patients with who has affected with COVID are dying. And many of them, which we have discussed previously, have many symptoms, including breathlessness, agitation, secretions, many other symptoms. So if these patients might be dying with many suffering, so if we can give proper end-of-life care, that would be giving them a death with dignity. So The end of life care will be led by Dr. Vinita. Dr. Vinita has done her MBBS and MSc in palliative medicine from Cardiff University, UK. And she has been working as a palliative care physician for many years. And at present, she is working as working in Aster MedCity Kochi in the oncology department. And welcome, Vinita. The next part, we know that after death or even before death, the patient and family experiences anticipatory grief, and because of the particular situation of COVID-19, the family even may not be able to see the patient's burial, or last rites are not given. So there are many problems in the death of the patient. So after, in the death and after death. So Smriti Rana will be talking about the grief and bereavement. She is the director of projects and programs of Palliam India. And basically she is a psychologist, but has been working in various capacities in palliative care for many years. Welcome, Smriti. And first, I would like to invite Vinita to have her presentation. Vinita, it's over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Chandra. I'll just share the file.
Vinita, are you sharing the presentation?
It's on my desktop. I'm just, I had not put it into my drive. Then will you be able to do it from there?
Yes, ma'am, of course. Okay. I will share.
Yeah. Very good afternoon, everybody. So today I'm here to speak to you on end of life care in COVID-19 patients. So I must begin to say that life closure, the management of life closure, is as important as life sustaining treatments. So let's move on and see. Next slide, please. Yeah. What is exactly end of life care? So end of life care, it basically involves end of life care basically involves treatment, care and support for people who are nearing end of life, their end of life, and it happens to be a part of palliative care. And in end of life, there is also a very important session of discussing and forming an action plan to maximize the comfort and avoid, so that you can avoid futile and burdensome interventions for patients at end of life, and thereby help to increase the quality of their life until death and their dying experience for all. So now when I use the word all over there, I would like to emphasize that in end of life care, again, we are not just talking about just the patient, but also his family and loved ones. So by practicing good end of life care management, we are able to give the patient a good death. So what exactly is good death? Most often we have heard people talking about, he had a very good death. He happened to die in his sleep. It was like a silent MI that he had. He was just so lucky. And then you would have, you've heard people say that, Mr. Y had such a bad death. I mean, he was in his bed struggling all his way for so many weeks together. Is good death or bad death just about, the time frame? So a good death is one that is free from avoidable distress and suffering for the patient, family, and caregivers, in general accord with the patient's and family's wishes, and reasonably consistent with clinical, cultural, and ethical standards. Next slide, please. So this is just a diagrammatic representation where you can see that from the point when the curative treatment starts, slowly as the curative treatment just does not start helping anymore, palliative care takes over and end of life care starts somewhere about, you know, a couple of months before death. And as end of life care again progresses and falls into terminal care, the patient dies and the care doesn't stop there. It goes on further to bereavement care. Next slide, please. So as I said before, end of life care is a part of palliative care and terminal care is a part of end of life care. So in palliative care, we do a lot of things, again, advanced care planning, we're talking about goals of care, we're talking about how to optimize the quality of life until death. We're talking about symptom assessments and educating the family, providing community support for the patient and family. In end of life care, again, it is all that. And it starts a couple of weeks to months before life. And at the point when there is no more active treatment, definitive treatment going on, and it is a more holistic approach over there. And again, when it comes down, further narrowed down to the last few hours before death or a couple of days before death, it is stringent pain and symptom management. Not just physical symptom, but psychosocial, emotional, and spiritual supports are being extended. And bereavement support and grief support also is extremely important after death. Next slide, please. So what exactly is the role of palliative care, end-of-life care, and bereavement care in COVID? This session is basically to empower each and every one of you with effective symptom control so that you can increase the quality of life until death, help in complex decision-making processes, and thereby give or provide holistic care of physical, psychosocial, and spiritual concerns of the patient, and thereby provide care support to patients, family, colleagues during this COVID-19 outbreak. Next slide, please. So who exactly are our target population? Who are at risk? We have the elderly on one side, we have the frail on one side, and then we have those who are suffering from serious illnesses and other comorbidities. So presence of COVID-19 may exacerbate the already coexisting illnesses, or it might just cause lack of reserve, and it just creates a situation where the patient becomes sick enough that they die. So we need to enhance our skills of discussing and reviewing advanced care plans for this set of high-risk patients, thereby ensuring a comfortable and dignified death and also supporting families and colleagues. Next, please. So it becomes a specific responsibility to ensure that essential palliative and end-of-life care is delivered to these two subsets of people. One, for those who are likely to be in their last year of life because they already have a pre-existing health condition. Two, those who may die as a consequence of infection with COVID-19. So it becomes a professional's responsibility to provide palliative and end-of-life care for symptom control in irreversible situations, and also to provide honest conversations about things like place of care, goals of care, and treatment escalations. So therefore, planning, as we call, it should be initiated as early as possible so that you can have a very personalized care plan. And this has to be documented. Next, please. So what exactly are the challenges that we are facing in end-of-life care in executing this? Here, as much as we have talked about, you know, the high-risk group, those with already existing serious illnesses, we are kind of prepared. The family is kind of prepared. There is some time. But here in COVID, we do not have time. We do not have much time in front of us because the patient has a sudden deterioration. The patient goes into a very fast respiratory failure. So where exactly is the time to make decisions? So we need to, they have to make a quick decision whether they want to be at home, to be treated at home or the hospital. Or if the patient is unable to do that, they need to select, or we need to select the substitute decision maker. And this is usually already being looked into in vulnerable, frail and patients with dementia. But otherwise, it becomes difficult. And again, for these proxy decision makers, they also undergo some amount of guilt, anxiety, fear, because they doubt their own capacity and knowledge to make such an important decision for a loved one. And also, they fear if they can change their decisions during the treatment phase of the patient. And there are times when they even doubt the competency and the knowledge of the doctors. There are difficult conversations that, you know, that, you know, we are more used to having difficult conversations with the help of non-verbal cues or in-person conversations. But here, in this scenario, it's going to be a lot different. There are not going to be use of non-verbal cues or in-person conversations. And it's going to be a totally new format. It's going to be telephonic or video conversations. And that is where actually the questionable professional skill comes to play, because how many of us are actually at ease to put forward our suggestions or what we have to convey through such media? Next, please. Communication at end of life care is very important because it helps to establish a good therapeutic relationship. It also helps to assess the acute illness of the patient, or what was the baseline health of the patient, what was the values of the patient, and also help in understanding the decision-making capacity of the patient, or else we have to rely on a substitute. And altogether, it helps to plan the treatment. Again, we have barriers. Barriers in terms of isolation, because obviously these patients are isolated. The caretakers, if they themselves are suffering from COVID, they are also asymptomatic probably. They are also isolated at home. And health workers, they are donned in their PPEs, and also there is strict visitor restrictions. So all these different areas, such as goals of care communication, symptom monitoring, end-of-life monitoring, sometimes gets affected. Next, please. The common signs and symptoms that is usually seen in end-of-life are quite a few. When I say about in particular to COVID, it would be predominantly breathing difficulty, and of course, a difficulty to take any oral foods or medications, and patients could be drowsy. They would need assistance for every care. Next, please. Assessment is to be made, done for the on the patient's needs. Patient needs are basically physical, and also psychological, and both have to be looked into with equal importance. Physical needs, mainly symptoms such as breathlessness, cough, sleep disturbances, they are sometimes confused and unable to take food. So the nutritional and fluid intake, which might be actually a more of concern for the family. So all these have to be addressed. And then we have the psychological needs on the other side. The patient wants to know how he's going to be doing, and there is a lot of anxiety and agitation which has to be managed, and a lot of concern about the family, because now that he has contracted the disease, he has exposed his family also to the disease, and this in turn causes a lot of anxiety, and the feel of being a burden also comes in. And again, a lot of anxiety on death and dying is also seen. Next, please. So in short, the whole cycle of end-of-life care is in such a way. It starts off with communication with the family members regarding end-of-life care, and then we start go on to managing the symptoms, distressing symptoms like breathlessness, agitation, respiratory secretions. And we form a holistic approach to address the physical, psychosocial, spiritual symptoms of the patient and the family with compassion. People belong to different faiths and they have different religious requirements, and all these have to be addressed. And even after death, procedures and logistics relevant for each healthcare center needs to be followed. Next, please. So as the time goes by, you keep physical examination still plays a pivotal role, because you have to keep and you have to keep adjusting your medications accordingly, of course under the cover of a PPE, and investigations are kept to the minimal and review of medications have to be done, and only the necessary medications are given. Next, please. The role of nursing care is paramount at this point of time. It is, again, it is not just the physical symptom, but it is also the psychosocial. So the other important areas of nursing care would be oral care, eye care, skin care, also care of the tubes, the nasogastric tube, which is for feeding, also the catheter. So these are all the different important areas of nursing care. And regarding the routes of administration for medications, the dictum is avoid intramuscular because the procedure itself causes pain. IV, if the patient has an IV line, go for IV, intravenous mode, or most preferred route is the subcutaneous. Buccal, rectal, topical, syringe drivers are also used. Next, please. Please also refer to the e-handbook of by Pali COVID on palliative care in COVID patients. It gives an algorithm for symptom control and all the other areas concerning palliative care. So the common problems which are seen in the last 48 hours is one, noisy and moist breathing, which is very commonly called as death rattle. And the medicines usually used, the drugs usually used are hyoscine hydrobromide, 400 microgram, can be given subcutaneously, or it can be on as stat doses, or it can be given even in a continuous infusion, being end of life. And it can be also other options are glycopyrronium bromide 0.2 milligram that again can be given as a continuous infusion. Injection hyoscine butyl bromide is also another option, and morphine can also be given to decrease the labored breathing of the patient. A little head and elevation, a little lateral positioning of the patient might help in a positional drainage of the secretions also. Gently deep suction is not done, and just a little gentle suction might be helpful. Benzodiazepines are also helpful. Next slide, please. Coming to managing a breathlessness, if the patient is alert, oral morphine can be given, or you can go for IV morphine or subcutaneous injections for 1 to 2 milligram. And that is for mild breathlessness, but it can be given along with the benzodiazepine like midazolam, 2.5 to 5 milligram IV or subcutaneous can be given forthrightly. Or it, another option is lorazepam, which is again a short acting, 0.5 milligram to 1 milligram. This can be given sublingually. In case of severe breathlessness, usually that we encounter in end of life in the last few hours, morphine can be given along with midazolam. and each of these drugs can be given as boluses, repeated every 15 to 30 minutes until the patient gets complete comfort. And then they can be started on continuous infusions and titrated according to the need. Next slide, please. Terminal agitation. If the patient is agitated, try to also find out if there is anything correctable, even if it is in the end of life. Probably the patient is in a lot of pain, or there is urinary retention, there is a full bladder, or probably a loaded rectum, or the patient is having some cerebral irritability or a lot of psychosocial concerns, anxiety and fear, or it is probably a side effect of one of the medications that you're using. So if there is anything correctable there, that can be done. And drugs commonly used for managing agitation is midazolam, haloperidol. Again, sublingual or rectal routes also can be tried. Sometimes it so happens that all these symptoms are refractory, and then we might have to go in for analgesic sedation. Next slide, please. In certain situations where we have to triage these patients, again, the algorithm for triage is given in the e-handbook. Please refer to that. And if we understand that the patients are not going to benefit from a hospital treatment like or a critical care treatment like NIV or even ventilation, they are given the option of managing the symptoms at home. So how do we conduct end-of-life care at home? Of course, patients have to be isolated from the family members, but yet at the time of caregiving, they can probably wear masks, gloves, and maintain the protective